It is my happy privilege to welcome you to this presentation. Wherever you are and wherever you may be, so nice to have you access and listen to it. My name is Brighton Cavallo, a Seventh-day Adventist ordained minister of religion, and also do serve as the Public Affairs and Religious Liberty Director of the South England Conference. Just before I make this presentation, I kindly invite you to a prayer with me. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity to share this presentation, particularly its message. May you guide us and lead us in accordance with your purpose and will for each one of us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let me, at this point, share with you the screen. I saw important that I do so, for the title of my presentation is on the first slide before you. Ministering to today's UK LGBT community in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. SDA represents that. Let me repeat the title. Ministering to today's UK LGBT plus community in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Are the purpose of my presentation, you may ask, is to enlighten both the Seventh-day Adventist Church leadership and its members, on one hand, and the LGBT plus community in the UK, seeking to help us understand and appreciate the gospel ministry of Jesus Christ, particularly in the Seventh-day Adventist Church organization. I intend to just merely highlight areas I consider are important. I won't be going into details as such that may come on some later day. Let me begin with what I would like to see the Seventh-day Adventist Church leadership at all levels and members seek to familiarize themselves or ourselves with the LGBT legislative process in the Scottish Parliament and Westminster Parliament. If I may point that this is important. From time to time, the government puts out to the public calls for evidence and consultations and require the public to respond to issues that will arise from time to time. So it is important to have an idea of the LGBT legislation, as it were. For you will notice here that the UK government legislation on LGBT plus really has two main provisions: the Gender Recognition Act 2004 and Equality Act 2010. These are provisions that legitimize same-sex marriages and transgender relationships, as it were. You will also see that the same gender recognition act 2004 and equality act has a timeline that provides the transgender the rights in the UK. So let me emphasize the point. It's just good to have a basic idea to what these entail. I say so because it will be interesting to note, particularly let me highlight the Equality Act 2010. Lord, others pronounced as Mackay, but those in Scotland, Lord Mackay of Clashfen, was the Lord Chancellor in 1987 to 1997. Among other things, the role of the Lord Chancellor, the place I have highlighted, states that he oversees the British jurisprudence. What he says on point of law is crucial and must be taken into account. On the issue of Equality Act 2010, when it was still a bill passing through Parliament, he raised some concerns. Obviously, at his during his time, he was retired. You will notice he served from 1987 to 1997. But just follow where I have highlighted. He noted, some types of equality can impinge on one another. Where two equalities compete, there may be a question whether one should prevail over the other. And indeed, you'll see he highlighted an area of concern. From the top, the relationship between freedom of religion and discrimination on the ground of sexual orientation is a good example of this problem with Equality Act 2010. Later on the second paragraph, it says, this bill, the Equality Act 2010, as it was going through, provides the opportunity to examine this issue properly. Went on, can Parliament find a way to provide the latter without riding roughshod over the consciences of those whose religious beliefs regard the practice of sexual relations outside marriage as sinful? This is an important challenge, vital to the degree of freedom of conscience. In a way, that issue then to this day has not been dealt properly. Yeah. So how important it is to have an idea, as it were. In the book, God and the Transgender Debate, by Andrew T. Walker, there is an article written by Dr. Albert Moeller. He puts the whole issue of transgender debate this way. The sexual revolution poses challenges that are not simply going to disappear. The church must be ready to meet these challenges with biblical fidelity and a Christ-like compassion. You will recall my main purpose in this presentation is how the Seventh-day Adventist must be able to address in its organization in the churches the issue of LGBT plus. Mola puts it that it is an area where biblical fidelity, whilst important to be maintained, but also a Christ-like compassion should be exercised. Bearing that in mind, I know there are many biblical principles in the Bible. I've just selected one. As the church organization, my organization, the Seventh-day Adventist organization, its leadership and members, we can do with the council, which I've just taken from 1 Peter chapter 3:15, to guide us, be able to handle this situation of LGBT plus in our organization. I begin with the New King James Version. It states, "But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear." I like it even more in the Amplified Bible, a more modern version. It states, "But in your hearts, set Christ apart as holy and acknowledge him as Lord. Always, not even when you decide and think through otherwise, always be ready to give a logical defense." Not just a defense, but a logical defense to anyone who asks you to account for the hope that is in you. But in addressing that defense, do it courteously and respectfully. As I said, I will not be going into details, but the Seventh-day Adventist Church leadership and its members, I include myself, we can do with such a council to remain with a spirit of compassion, exercising courtesy and respect, particularly in areas we may not be familiar with, as it were. That said, the Seventh-day Adventist World Church Executive Committee took a decision on transgenderism. That was done on the 11th of April, 2017. And Arthur Steele was the Seventh-day Adventist Church Vice President who presided over that decision. This was meant to be rolled out around the world where Seventh-day Adventists are, to see whether they can be given some guidance in dealing with the LGBT issue in its congregation. Let me provide you the lead statement first. Statement on transgenderism. The Seventh-day Adventist took this decision. I read it in your hearing. "The increasing awareness of the needs and challenges that transgender men and women experience and the rise of transgender issues to social prominence worldwide raise important questions, not only for those affected by transgender phenomenon, but also for the Seventh-day Adventist Church. The last paragraph I've highlighted. Yet, we believe, as the Seventh-day Adventist organization that is, we believe that Scripture provides principles for guidance and counsel to transgender people and the church. So what I'll be sharing with you is not just for the transgender people who come to our local congregation, our local church, wherever that may be, but also it is counsel to the local church members in the audience, in that church. That council transcends human conventions and culture. Allow me to repeat. The Seventh-day Adventist Church believes that Scripture provides principles for guidance and counsel, if you please, to LGBT plus people and the church that transcends human conventions and culture. Indeed, in other words, the Bible, the Word of God, must be sought carefully to give that guidance, while appreciating, obviously, human conventions, legislations, and culture, but the Word of God, the Bible, must provide the ultimate guidance. In the statement that was issued, there were 10 provisions. I've just selected 4 because of the time setting. Point number 7. Now, this is for the church, as it addresses the transgender or LGBT issue in its local congregation. 7 states, the Bible commands followers of Christ to love everyone. Created in the image of God, they must be treated with dignity and respect. This includes transgender people. Acts of ridicule, abuse, or bullying towards transgender people are incompatible with the biblical commandment, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Remember earlier, when LGBT people come and would like to be part of worshiping, characteristics that have been mentioned must not take place. I repeat, ridicule or suggesting bullying in any shape or form. The Seventh-day Adventist Church has taken that stance. Even more importantly then, see point 8. The church, meaning the Seventh-day Adventist Church, as the community of Jesus Christ, is meant to be a refuge and a place of hope, care, and understanding to all who are perplexed, suffering, struggling, and lonely. For a bruised reed he will not break, and a smoking flax he will not quench. Matthew 12, verse 20. The latter part states, all people, not some, all people are invited to attend the Seventh-day Adventist Church and enjoy the fellowship of its believers. Can I repeat? All people, not certain people, all people are invited to attend the Seventh-day Adventist Church and enjoy its spiritual fellowship. But the latter part provides also an important distinction. Those who are members, bona fide members, can fully participate in church life as long as they embrace the message, the mission, and the values of the church. I wish I had more time. While LGBT folk are invited to attend, only members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church can fully participate in the church life per se, particularly those who embrace the biblical guidance we have talked about, its mission, and even more importantly, the values of what the church truly stands for. Point 9, both to the church and to the LGBT, virtually to everyone, point 9 must be taken to heart. The Bible, remember earlier I said, the Bible transcends any conventional culture. It has the last saying. Point 9, the Bible proclaims the good news that sexual sins committed by heterosexuals, homosexuals, transgender people, or others can be forgiven and lives can be transformed through faith in Jesus Christ. Very important, both for the church to appreciate that statement and for the LGBT or whatever category you may find yourself. All have sinned, all have come short of the glory of God. But what is heartwarming, that God himself can provide that forgiveness and bring about a transformation through Jesus Christ, our Lord, if one so desires. So you can see here, it's not only LGBT, but any other form of sin must be acknowledged. Transformation can take place through Jesus Christ, our Lord. The last point that was made during the statement. Those who experience incongruity between their biological sex, the sex they were born in, and a gender identity, remember, they are allowed to come and worship. But see what this brings about. They are encouraged to follow biblical principles in dealing with their distress. They are invited to reflect on God's original plan of purity and sexual fidelity. Belonging to God, all, not some, all are called to honor him with their bodies and their lifestyle choices. 1 Corinthians 6:19. With all believers transgender people are encouraged to wait on God and are offered the fullness of divine compassion, peace, grace, in anticipation of Christ's soon return, when all true followers of Christ will be completely now restored to God's idea. How important, therefore, it is to encourage, to be compassionate as God works out his purpose in the lives of those who may be struggling with any issue, knowing that there is restoration, there is transformation through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Therefore, that said, let me conclude really on this diagram that victory over LGBT community sexual sins one can experience. Starting from my left going towards my right, you will notice at creation, the book of Genesis, Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 began, "In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth." You find people today says, no, this world just evolved. Not believing what God actually has said. Genesis chapter 1, verse 27. "So God created mankind, male and female, he created them." Mankind comes today and says, no, you can choose whatever sex you want. Genesis chapter 2, verse 2. "After all had been created, God on the seventh day, God rested and hallowed it." Mankind says, no, you can choose any other day, whether first, second, or third. The cost of going against God has been terrible. Transgression, Eden lost. If you come at the bottom, you will see as a result of mankind, rebellion, sin has caused not only us losing out to what God had intended from the beginning, but we were not just left like that. This is where I would like to encourage my church, encourage myself to be patient with the LGBT community in seeking to lead, to encourage that we have not just been left, as it were, to fend for ourselves. Look to my right. The gospel of Jesus Christ, salvation in Jesus Christ, redemption in Jesus Christ, has replaced the fallen nature to take place, and then transformation, which was transformation to take place. Eden lost because of rebellion and sin. It's now and will be Eden restored through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And you will see at the very top then in Isaiah 65:17, "For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered nor come into mind. A recreation that leads to eternity. I'm ending on this note. At a time such as this, let us, first of all, fellow leaders and members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, be kind, be patient, seek to encourage, but at the same time, those who may have been struggling with LGBT, seek to place themselves in the hand of the mighty God and allow him to bring about that transformation according to your desire for him to do so. Therefore, the gospel ministry must be highlighted, and let me end on the note that if you may want me to provide you with more resources or to talk through this presentation with you, please do contact me. But I'm so grateful that the Seventh-day Adventist Church has sought to address how we as leaders, we as members, must allow everyone to worship with us, but provide a demarcation that only those members in good standing, in the sense that they have sought to accept fully the mission and the value that God has given as guidance, must be allowed to lead, must be allowed to fully participate. So thank you for taking some time, listen to this message, and share it where possible. God bless you.